If you were terminally ill, would you want to know? And if I had the cure for your disease, would you want me to share it with you? No good doctor takes pleasure in telling a patient that they have a terminal illness, but no good doctor would withhold that devastating news either. I'm not a medical expert, I'm a preacher. My concern isn't necessarily with the health of your physical body, though I do believe in miracles. My concern is the state of your soul. I have good news for you. There's a cure for man's greatest ill. Sin has infected everyone. Everyone has been infected with sin. The world is full of darkness because the world is full of sin. You're sin sick, whether you know it or not, but there is a cure. Jesus said this, "For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life." Whoever you are, whatever you've done, God loves you. He loves you so much that he sent his Son into the world to save you. But from what does Jesus save? Why do you need a Savior? The Bible says that all have sinned, every single one of us. That definitely includes me. It includes you too. We've all done things that have violated the holy standard of God. For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. There's no escaping this truth. All have sinned. So what are we to do about sin? Should we do good deeds? Does feeling bad for what we've done cleanse us from the wrongdoing? The Bible says this, "No one is righteous, not even one." In other words, there's not much we can do to save ourselves. Even if you were to spend the rest of your life doing good, even if you were to dedicate the rest of your life to a just cause, even if you were to show kindness to all for the rest of your life, you'd still fall short of God's holy standard. Furthermore, all who have sinned will be punished for their sin. The Bible says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord." Now, some might say, "But God is kind, he's loving, he's good, he's gracious, he's merciful. Surely he'll show mercy to me." Now, if a man were to murder a child, you would be appalled by his crime, no doubt. You would count on a good judge to punish the man to the fullest extent allowable by law. That's your sense of justice, your conscience. Here's what's interesting. When it comes to the mistakes of others, we cry out for justice. When it comes to our own mistakes, we expect mercy. God will judge sin because he is a good judge, because he is a good God. God will punish every wrong. Words, thoughts, and deeds. The punishment for sin is death. The punishment for sin is hell. The sins of the world are piling up. But because you are stubborn and refuse to turn from your sin, you are storing up terrible punishment for yourself. For a day of anger is coming when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. Now, I know that's offensive to some, but it's not my goal to be offensive, nor do I take pleasure in sharing that reality with you. But that's what the Bible teaches. No debates, no reasoning, that's reality, and we all know it deep within our hearts. The reason people are offended by the idea of hell is because they aren't offended enough by their own sins. We've all violated God's standard. The punishment fits the crime. The judge doesn't let the murderer go just because of the good deeds he's done. Neither will God let you go because of your good deeds. Now, here is the good news. God is also merciful. His holiness punishes sin, but his mercy forgives sinners. Here's how God rescued you while also holding to his holy standard. God came to earth as a man, the God-man, Jesus Christ. Jesus lived a perfect life. He never sinned. Then he died on a cross for your sins. He took your place. He took your punishment. He satisfied the holiness of God. You couldn't save yourself even if you tried for 1,000 years, so God had to rescue you. You couldn't pay your debt of sin, so God paid it for you. Despite what others might have told you, the way to salvation is rather simple. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. So right now, I'm pleading with you. Turn from your sins. Turn to the Lord. Humble yourself and throw yourself on His mercy. Take Him up on His offer. This is what God says to you. Come now, let's settle this. Though your sins are like scarlet, I will make them as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, I will make them as white as wool. He gave you the gift of life. He doesn't ask a hard thing of you. Seek God while there's still time. Exchange your selfishness for His love, your sins for His righteousness, your guilt for His peace. The gospel is simply this: Jesus will give you His eternal life in exchange for your temporary one. If you're ready to give your life to the Lord right now, I want to lead you in a prayer, but keep this in mind and hear me because this is very important. This prayer is not what saves you. These aren't magic words that you can just pray and then be saved. That's not even in the Bible. Prayer never saved a soul. Only Jesus saves. I'm simply guiding you as you surrender to the Lord, but this is between you and the Lord. If you truly repent of your sins, if you sincerely ask for His forgiveness, then God will respond. Let's go to Him now. He's watching you and listening to you right now. Say this to Him. Say, "Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you as a sinner. I admit that I have sinned. I admit that I've done wrong. And I admit that I can't save myself. I ask you today to forgive me of my sins." Say this to the Lord. Say, "Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. And I believe you rose again from the dead. I humble myself today, asking you to save me, to change me. I surrender my life to you. I turn from my sin today. Be my Lord, my God, my King, my friend, and my Savior. I declare by faith right now, now and forevermore, I belong to you. In the name of Jesus." And I want you to say amen. If you prayed that prayer, you just made the greatest decision of your life. And now it's time to commit to the Lord. Go now, serve the Lord, walk in holiness, turn from your sins, and begin to grow spiritually. I would like to invite you to become a member of Spirit Church, which is our online community of believers. We have almost 12,000 members from all around the world, and when you join Spirit Church, you'll receive from me every single week a brand new teaching from the Word of God. I want the privilege of helping you grow in Christ. You'll also get a worship cover from Stephen Moctezuma, which will help you to worship God. And then, of course, you can always reply to that email for prayer support. Join the Spirit family today. If you'd like information on how you can join Spirit Church right now, it's absolutely free. 200 sermons plus, 200 worship clips plus, hundreds of videos, thousands of hours, lots of content to help you grow spiritually. Then sign up today. Go to davidhernandezministries.com/spiritchurch. Join the Spirit family today and gather with us as we gather in spirit. I'm David Diga Hernandez, and that is your Moment of Truth. Again, just reminding you, if you'd like to join Spirit Church, go to davidhernandezministries.com/spiritchurch. Join the growing community of believers from all around the world. Join the Spirit family today. Again, davidhernandezministries.com/spiritchurch. Thank you for watching Encounter TV. Don't forget to subscribe and click the notification bell. Also, help us spread the gospel of Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. Make a one-time donation or become a monthly supporter by clicking on the donate link now.